coaches, leading artists, explore the stories that define their genres. This is AMC Visionaries. The Marvel Universe is a pervasive, gigantic part of pop culture.
Marvel is a powerhouse today, but most people don't realize they almost didn't exist.
People think that Stan Lee just came on the scene and created these great characters, not realizing he'd already been there in the industry for a couple of decades. Start to unravel the history and realize that it all began with Stan Lee gone, just don't want to do this, almost walking away from comics.
I had wanted to quit working there. I wanted to do a lot of things that were different.
Marvel had a lot of luck in its corner as far as timing.
If we didn't have Stan Lee and Jack Kirby in the right place at the right time, we wouldn't be talking about Marvel Comics today.
You think about Stan Lee and Jack Kirby writing all of these comic books that have now become these iconic movies. It's just amazing.
Stan and Jack Kirby together was a monumental turn in the history of pop culture that nobody saw coming.
There wasn't anything that would lead you to think that these guys were going to change the world.
Humans. And I think that Stan Lee and Jack Kirby really brought those characters, made them very complex from the beginning, and ultimately resonated with people.
the idea that a team of superheroes would have fights and break up, it just blew my mind. And it's immediately better than the Superman Batman comics I was reading.
Luckily, the book sold, and my publisher said, give me another
book,
Stan. We're going strong. Let's do some more.
Pit Floyd using Doctor Strange thus disseminating Marvel comics into the culture and having them take hold.
beyond your core audience. And for a lot of us who love comic books, having somebody reference something you know, you're like, oh my god, A, you're cool, B, I know that as well, and C, it's great that you brought it into this thing. There was Gear Fonda calling himself Captain America, and he's a writer.
This year's Captain America.
What is the story of Captain America? What kind of a
cat is he?
Well, we revived him from the so-called Golden Age of comics. He's become satirical because we claim he's great.
It must have been really cool for Jack Kirby to bring back Captain America and really do his character in a whole new way. He became kind of this disillusioned American. We see this growing ambition in both Stan Lee and Jack Kirby that it becomes almost a social criticism. X-Men were created in the 60s in a time of civil rights, of turmoil, and awareness. I mean, most of all, the X-Men is about tolerance and not pushing away outsiders.
One of the things I've always been against is bigotry, and the X-Men fans have told me that that series is one of the greatest battle against bigotry that I could have written.
You can see how the civil rights movement influenced some of those early X-Men. You've got senators like speaking out against these people who aren't like you and I, these giant robots called the Sentinels. This story came out shortly after there were armed guards assaulting black people. It's hard to not see the parallels.
Our fan mail, about one-third of it, very seriously, would be from college kids who'd say, I'm doing a dissertation about this, a doctoral thesis about this, and STEM, really, what was behind thus and such happening?
I probably visited more college campuses than any living being.
As the decade progressed, Stan came into inventing himself as much as he would invent any other character. He started as this bald, nebbishy guy, and he ended the decade this larger-than-life figure that went around college campuses exclaiming all of these ridiculous alliterative things. Life is so insane that if you try to do anything that is the way things would be in real life, it has to come across like satire. So all of a sudden I learned that I'm a satirist. In a lot of ways, Stan's life became Stan's art. And him taking center stage may not sit as well with somebody like Jack Kirby, who regards, hey, I'm doing the real work here. Jack was known and respected in the community and by hardcore comic book aficionados. But, you know, if you go to the average person and say, who's Jack Kirby? They might be like, oh no, you say it's Stan Lee. Oh, Spider-Man, Marvel Comics. This was the problem with Stan and Jack's relationship in a big bad way. Robert Kirby. Shouldn't I get some extra compensation for this? It was kind of like, just shut up and go back to drawing stuff.
publisher wants it all. The creative people are on a certain plane, and the publisher is on a certain plane. England's with his lawyers and accountants. And he says, well, let's get toys out of this. Let's get sweaters out of this.
So I understand what might have been there. I think sometimes he got this place against Stan, to the extent that Stan was his oppressor, more than, say, the publisher or something. It's pretty hard. He saw Stan advancing and so forth and being considered the prime mover of the Marvel Universe. Reason that I could live with. It was the same thing with Steve Ditko when he left one day. To this day, I don't know why he left. Things happen. I was thinking of it as the Bob Iwerks syndrome. You know, Bob Iwerks. Bob Iwerks was Walt Disney's, you know, his second command in all areas. He's the guy who probably actually drew more of Mickey Mouse and knew more about the animation. But Bob Iwerks got the feeling unappreciated after 2 years. He went off and found his own animation studio. His failed.
Kirby went to DC and he did a series of stories that are kind of known as New Gods. At the time, there was a lot of criticism of the storytelling and the dialogue. You know, everyone loved the art, but it wasn't Stan Lee.
The thing about Kirby is he couldn't write. We found out for sure. He had a terrible ear for dialogue. Just, you know, off-putting, clanky dialogue. And then he parodied Stan's Funky Fleischman in a couple of his books. Kind of a glib, salesman-type guy, making fun of Stan's persona. Stan and I got an argument one time. I felt Jack Kirby was right. It was a mistake at the company. He was so basically telling me, well, yeah, but I wasn't the one who did it. And I said, you ever see all those Dean Martin Nicholas movies? I said, there's always a scene in those movies where Dean Martin says to somebody, hey, you can't do that to my pal. I said, Stan, I wish you said that more often. And he didn't speak to me for a long time after that. These two middle-aged men basically started from almost desperation and created all these popular revolutionary characters. Unfortunately, along the way, their relationship fell apart. The tension that they had behind the scenes really put all their good work into jeopardy.
Each other, and to say, a great synergy in terms of their creativity. It was on his birthday, Jack Kirby was doing an interview on the radio, and one of the callers was Stan Lee.
Be interesting to know whether or not Galactus' exit speech in FF number 50 was an example of Jack's dialogue or Stan's. But you
must say this, every word of dialogue in those scripts was mine.
Well, I can tell you that I wrote a few lines myself about every panel.
Yes, I've seen those.
And when I printed in the book.
Alright, look, both of you, hey, kids. I really think, and look, Jack, nobody has more respect for you than I do, and you know that. But I don't think you ever felt that the dialogue was that important. And I think you felt that it doesn't matter. Anybody can put the dialogue in, it's what I'm drawing that matters. And maybe you're right, I don't agree with it, but maybe you're right.
You feel like you're intruding on a heavy talk between an ex-husband and an ex-wife or something. And the semi-reconciliation is playing out in real time.
You know, Jack, you were talking earlier about your drawing and people sometimes criticized your figures. I always felt that the most important thing about your drawings, I remember when I was a kid and I first saw Captain America, it wasn't the correctness of the anatomy, but it was the emotion that you put in. Nobody could convey emotion and drama the way you could. And nobody could ever draw a hero like you could. And I think that's something you can be very proud of, and I'm proud of you for it.
I have to thank you for helping me to keep that style, Stanley, and whenever we get together, we got sales from Marvel.
I think it was more than that, Jack. We certainly got the sales, but whatever we did together, and no matter who did what, and I guess that's something that'll be argued forever, but I think there was some slight magic that came into effect when we worked together, and I am very happy that we had that experience.
Well, I was never sorry for it, Stanley. It was a great experience for me.
It's easy to cast real people and human decisions with the brush of intention and with the brush of, you know, heroes and villains, but it really just came down to these were people with all of the messiness of human dynamics. They were working in the underclass of the publishing business. There wasn't anything that would lead you to think that these guys are going to change the world with what's going on inside their heads.
It was Marvel's 25th anniversary. I invited him. And he came. And Ross, his wife, came. Stan and I were standing in the back room. He came in. Stan had a glass of wine. And you know Stan talks. He stands around all. Raises his hand. Slams against a pillar. Hand is slashed. Bleeding. Gets a handkerchief out of his hand. I said, "There's Jack." So I run over to Jack and Ross and bring them over to Stan. And here's Stan. Like this. And Jack is in his hand. And Stan goes, he shakes it. And then he's wiping the blood off Jack's hand. And they talk for a while. And then everyone through friends and talking about how great it used to be. And it was fun, you know, and all the good times they had. And then Stan's like, "You know, I don't care who gets credit, don't care who loves. So just really do one more time, one more job." And Ross said, "Forget it, and drag Jack away." So, and that.
While they remain cordial, unfortunately, they never worked together again before Kirby passed away. There's a few different people that can play the Moses role in the history of comics, and Jack Kirby's one of them. He was able to lead us to this promised land of story that he didn't get to enjoy it himself. I think when you look at people that have come up from that environment, creators negotiating for a fair piece of what they create in the way that Rob Liefeld gets a piece of every piece of Deadpool, whether it's Robert Kirkman controlling his own destiny, creating something like The Walking Dead, they were informed by the fact that Jack Kirby didn't receive that. And it was those stories that made me go into my career with my eyes wide open. I'm going, they can do it to Jack Kirby. They can do it to anybody. They call him the king. Rightfully so. And if there's a bigger word than that, I give it to him.
I don't think anybody was as much a master of the art as Jack was. And he was just the greatest. In fact, I'm the guy who gave him the nickname, Jack King Kirby. He was the king of the artist to me.
My name isn't Stan Lee. It's Stanley Lieber. Someday I'm going to write the great American novel, and I don't want to use this name that's going to be so famous someday. Use it on comics. Stan Lee.
Funny thing, maybe in an alternate universe, Stan did write the great American novel. It flopped, and he was never heard from again.
Stan did create something akin to the Great American Novel by creating this huge Marvel universe. And by creating, I mean being part of something that all these other people were involved in to help shape it into what it is.
I worked with Steve Ditko, and I worked with Jack, and it's very clear that Stan wasn't pulled his way. He was the glue that held it all together. He was conducting the orchestra.
I don't think he took too much credit. I think he created the whole thing. Sorry, obviously, he couldn't have done it without Jack Kirby or Ditko or the other artists, but, you know, certainly without Stan Lee, no Marvel Comics.